afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to another exciting propaganda cast to the 1,000 Companies 2 Propaganda Cast with me, your host, Imperial Dane. Yes, indeed, 1,000 episodes. That's quite a number. I have a video up sort of more specifically discussing that, so I won't be going into much to it. In this here, of course, we've still got a battle of headers, but still, you know, 1,000 episodes. That's a bit of a milestone, and not something everybody does, so that's quite impressive. Huzzah and all that. But still, we've got a battle of headers. We've got here in the South Mirage fighting for the Wehrmacht, for Deutschland, for the 21st Panzer Division going up versus the North. We've got Admiral Shrapnel fighting for King and Country, for the Commonwealth, for the 7th Armored Division. And we got here Storm Doctrine Fortified Armored Encirclement. Quite a bit of a mix there with Panzer Grenadier Bulletins all the way there versus Admiral Shrapnel with Mobile Assault, Tactical Support, and Vanguard Operations Regiment with Machine Gun and Infantry Bulletins. We got Pioneers, double Pioneers up over here from Mirage for language to grab more territory initially, heading eastwards, then west, the gun is heading westward. So that's an interesting way there. He's sort of trying for us up to suppose disruptive opening using his Pioneers while the gun is then just sort of relegated, taking territory. Admiral Shrapnel going for infantry sections and a Vickers with more infantry sections on the way.
Infantry squad trained and ready to go.
So that should be somewhat interesting. We got more Grenadiers on the way from Mirage Flat. Pox have been grabbed, and this is after the hot fix, where they did have to revert the veterans and changes. They'll probably do them somehow next week then, I guess. Took more work, I suppose, than they initially figured. Of course, then they have to fix them, so of course, I'll see how that goes. Our way, Vic, something at the Pioneers. One squad suppressed, we've still got the other unit moving in there. Ready to flank those for Dante Interlaffen. Moving up for the MP40s, they'll go catch the Vickers in a bit of a bad spot there. Trying to move away, but at the same time, the Pioneers, what are they about? There we go, he's forced to retreat, simply put. Too many units versus one Vickers. And he's fact to see that Evil Shrapnel's going for a second Vickers. That's actually an interesting sort of approach here. Double section, double Vickers, a bit rare. Most players tend to go for like two section Vickers or three section Vickers or three sections tech up. But he's actually going for double sections, double Vickers. Meanwhile, Mirage Flash just going for Grenadiers so far after the Pioneers. No MD42s, Granatenwerfers, or snipers. So right now we're actually seeing Mirage was actually playing for the fuel points, so we're seeing sort of Admiral Shrapnel sort of fighting to hold the center. He's rather losing control of the sides and of course the fuel points that way. It's a bit of a risky move here, and so far seems like a rather good start then for Mirage Flash.
But
of course Admiral Shrapnel will of course be back here with more anger, more fury, and more machine guns. Of course, I have to see how this actually works out. But three Grenadiers, two Pioneers versus two sections and two Vickers. Neither side has yet to go for Doctrine. Third section warrior. This Admiral Shrapnel is going for a rare, heavy British Tier 1. And most British players at the moment just go for like three units. And, you know, then they tag up. But Admiral Shrapnel is actually going for five here. That is, again, rare. That is very rare. Meanwhile, Mirage Flash already taking up here. Grabbing territory there. Compared to Mirage Flash, opening is a bit, you know, lighter. Only three Grenadiers and extra Pioneer Squad. Not quite nearly as expensive. Pioneers there, though, were taking losses. We're seeing here more of an effort there towards west now here from Admiral Shrapnel. And there we go, he's finally taking up as well. Though even then, I mean, by British standards, this is a late tech, but I mean, you know, it's not really that late. But again, it's by British standards, this is actually somewhat late.
We're
only 4 minutes into the game. I mean, most British players just, you know, take up so fast because they can. Pioneers are being suppressed by the Vickers, section moving up. Bit of quiet there. We've got Flanwerfers for the Pioneers, Granatenwerfer and Mirage Flap. Investing more into the Tier 1, those yet to take up. And we got Pioneers running back, so they might soon be allowed to make a nice company up. 2-2-2s, half tracks. Panzer Grenadier, I'd be a bit surprised, you know, if he doesn't get them. But then again, some players just, you know, get for a lot of bullets and never use the units available for them. Or maybe just use them sort of like mind games, just, you know, insinuating to the opponent, I'm going to go for a lot of these, and then round they go for something completely different. But there we go, east side lost here. Now we got an Edible Shrapnel finally being hit, grabbing the fuel point. Finally, we got Sabres on the way here for Edible Shrapnel. He's yet to choose a Doctrine. Now there's Mirage Flare. No Mobile Assault, no Tactical Support, no Vanguard. in that sense, you know, mobile assault also stands out from the other doctrines. And it's a primarily sort of earlier game doctrine. The vast majority of the abilities within like the three first points there compared to others where, you know, you might have some, but the vast majority tends to be sort of much later than that. And certainly hence tend to have a lot more heavier sort of CP-wise abilities in the end. The Vicar section there, Pioneers bringing up with their Flammenwerfers. Los Helmut! You must burn those Tommies out! Vicar's moving about there, we got Grenadiers hiding all the way up there! I wonder what Marshmallow's doing that for. Wonder why. We got the Light to Mega Nice coming down, we got nothing yet out there for Mirage. His mortars firing into the center of the map. Here we got Savage moving up with Minesweepers. Sections firing away, Pioneers need to fall back. Edward Shrapnel is certainly on the counter offensive now against the Huns. Pioneers doing with the cannon overall. Mirage's interest is being rather extended. They are low on health, low on numbers, being pushed to their very extremes. Which is honestly a bit risky. There we go, we got Panzer Gunner here now arriving here for Mirage Trap. Ebel Shrapnel, not really doing much. No armored cars, no buffers. There we go, mobile assault. Not too huge a surprise. I mean, new doctrines tend to be a lot more popular, obviously, in particular when they're free to offer. But obviously, there's going to be, you know, things that generally don't follow that template, like Overwatch. I think it was called there, the Orbital Commander Best one with Goliaths and so on. There's one that I think will stick around a bit. Infiltration Commandos, Flamethrowers, Land Mattresses. Vickers been moving towards the center section living up there. Making progress. We got more Sabs on the way there. Purple Shrapnel probably going to get them the M2 flamethrower. I'm not sure if the British actually had their own flamethrower. They would use something else, to be honest, in that sense. But I do know they had some of their own more unique flamethrower systems. But enemy threatening a capture point. Grabbing territory there was a Panzer Grenadier. So flamethrowers or what? No armored cars. No buffers. The buffer certainly has become a lot more popular thanks to the other doctrine. I'm also just seeing more people using them just more aggressively in larger numbers, which is probably honestly a bit where you need to use them again. Some units just don't work when they're just, you know, completely on their own. And one example. Vickers is down there. Vickers trying to deal with the flamethrower. Not the best exchange. I think the flamethrower team should be able to win that one. Pioneers bring it. Grenadiers have got section. Oh, catching the mortar there. Bad news from Mirage. We need to get his men out of there. Panzer Grenadier are hiding all the way over there, seemingly a bit forgotten. Vickers grabbed here by the Wehrmacht, added to its arsenal. And there we go, flamethrowers up. We've got a mortar in place going up here for Edward Shrapnel as well. Right behind the town square, they're able to fire into it and cover a nice chunk of the map there. That's going to be problems there for Mirage Flar, and actually controlling the center there, and even moving up around some of the areas as well there. So, a pretty strong mortar in place from there for Edible Shrapnel. And of course, the grid's going to come down here from your arse. How is the hell he's going to deal with that? Savage engaged, being engaged by the Panzer Gunner anyway to get Baldur Lardening off. And. Oh! Tried to dodge it. That did not work out very well. Almost got a full wipe there. Mortars are running down there. Mostly misses the Panzer Gunner squad, in fact, meaning not a single scratch on them. Maybe a bit of dirt though. God, so British. Absolutely uncivilized. Look at this! My boots are dirty! No tech up here for Mirage Flash of yet, no doctrine still. Also got access to advanced cover combat. Enemy he's got three sections that can take advantage of it. Points. A good push with it could do some damage, but of course the question is, do they actually want to use it like that? He can also now, of course, call in the Infiltration Commandos, a bit of sort of a awkward name. I mean, commanders were essentially infiltrators to a certain extent.
The enemy caught us a supply
stuff like that, you know, elite. Light infantry for attacking and so on.
A capture point is being overrun.
But you know, just as opposed to further differentiate them between the other types of commandos they have in the game here. Got Taz ring up to the Panzers who are suppressed, forced away there, grabbing the territory there. I mean, he's got two Panzer Grenadier squads, that's quite handy. Showing a lot of firepower there, and there we go, we got the infiltration commanders out. Popping up here, right behind them, a quick light cannon bomb off there versus Harry Hunt. Trying to catch units here, doing a lot of damage with their silent Sten guns. Light gammon off there, Savage are up to support with their own Sten guns. The Sten gun was a submachine gun with a rather mixed reputation. Particularly the earlier variants were rather unreliable. And was called the Plumber's Special. It was a very simple submachine gun to make, but it had a lot of issues. It was only later when a toy MiG, I think, got his hands on it, they sort of managed to make it notably more reliable. But I mean, you'll for example see references to German soldiers actually quite happy to be able to grab one compared to an MP40, because compared to an MP40 they had to use it while lying down due to the magazine. And the thing is, the Sten gun, being sort of a commando weapon to some extent, was actually designed to use German 9mm ammunition, parabellum. So for the German art soldier, seizing a Sten gun wouldn't have caused them any problems. They could easily got an ammo for it anyways. So that's a little fun detail there. Panzer Grenadier Pioneers moving up here. We've got the infiltration commandos hanging about. Hoping not to get spotted by the Huns, but there they are. Opening up with the Sturmgewehrs, the commandos out in the open are easy targets for the Panzer Grenadier. Hardened soldiers of the 21st Panzer Division, which was actually an elite division. But it wasn't actually a division, got its name, it just, you know, I believe had an armband that said 21st Panzer Division. That was basically how most of the units in the German army were rated as, you know, elite. If they had an armband, they were basically that elite. Standing by. And could basically just, you know, expect to be better supplied and sort of get priority there doing fighting. Fun fact there, for those that weren't aware. Panzer Grenadiers. What's the 21st actually elite? I'm thinking of the 2nd. Some of those number divisions were basically rated as elite and just had their name, you know, on the armband, just the number there. No fancy names there. Panzer Grenadier sent back there pretty quickly. Take up there for Mirage Plus, yet to take advantage of it, make any use of it. Still nothing here. I mean, Edward Shrapnel is not really playing to the full extent here with the British. No snipers, no anti-tank guns, no armored car, no buffers. He's been used the commander's flamethrowers and so on there, but it. Certainly not quite your fully usual British play, though it's certainly working. I mean, I'm not saying you should never, you know, play out of sight, you know, what is usually playing. In fact, I argue you should always try and find some other way, because what most is usually playing, you know, also tends to be sort of what also is, you know, obvious and can be counted more easily. But, again, in that sense, what Edward Schrammer is doing is certainly standing out. Quickly sneaking up there past the German Vickers there. And there we go, quickly sending the German crew there running, Sten guns firing away.
Enemy causing trouble, trying to take one of our points.
Ooh, deep flank here with some grenadiers, but at the same time, right behind them, we got sections cutting off their path, mortifying away here. Panzer Grenadier moving in to Deutschland, and we got the Sapoma Corps up here. At the same time, we got here Edel Shrapnel taking up, so might affect B1, he hasn't gone for any of this yet to himself. Wanted to rush ahead, go for a tier 3 much faster. I mean, in that sense, that does make sense. But it is a bit rare, of course, you know, having seen the last couple of months where it's pretty much just being a business as usual to quickly go for an armoured car and then take it from there, usually spawning it with a sniper. So it's all of a sudden see someone again this quickly just thinking, you know what, we don't need that, let's just go for some tanks. Panzer is here versus Sapper. Unit lost. Mortar crew seems to have been annihilated there. Bit of a loss there for Mirage.
Our capture point.
Right, they're being pushed back by the sections. In fact, almost looked like he's lost the Grenadier squad. In fact, he might have there. Underestimated the Tommies. Never a good thing. Got a single light machine gun out there for the Grenadier. So, what's Edward Shrapnel going to do now? Is he going to call up the land matches, or is he going to get some tanks? He could go for Centaur. But of course, he might be more centered to go for Cromwell, at least initially. Before going for anything else. I mean, we've certainly got a Panzer IV on the way. In that sense, Edel Shrapnel's currently got zero anti-tank weapons on the field, so he's in fact very vulnerable to an armor push there from Mirage Flyer. So Cromwell will be necessary alongside at least one 6-pounder gun. If he wants a decent chance of surviving. And we got a doctrine from Mirage Flyer. It is Storm Doctrine. A doctrine you occasionally see, but not very often. Note what he's doing. He's actually getting all of his panzer gun at his ambush camouflage. That's another rare one. But certainly will give them a bit of boost there when they do sort of appear out of it, sort of allow them to take a close quarters, do some good extra damage. We of course have to see how much else the doctrine uses. We've got section of fighting. Note, by the way, upgrades there for the men. No bolted sections or Bren guns. That could be quite helpful there versus Mirage Flyer. Large assault tier, panzers moving up with ambush camouflage gun, these M4 supporting Panzer 4 moving up. Sections and commanders charging forward, need to be careful that Panzer 4 blitzing the way forward. Commanders in fact need to be really careful there, careful. A little shrap. Ah, bollocks. That went pear shaped there for the commando team. Wiped out there by some pretty stalwart German panzer grenadier and a Panzer 4. Mine went off there, killing half the unit. Jürgen, Dietrich, dead. Maimed and broken. Panther running straight into the mine. Damaged engine. Cromwell striking in there. Ooh, could be a bit of vengeance there for the commanders, but also give the Devil Shrapnel the arm advantage. But Mirage flies quick to get a pack 40, and at the same time, Devil Shrapnel's getting himself a 6-pounder gun. But that pretty much there looks like Devil Shrapnel's fight there. The Panther Force already too heavily damaged there. Just one more hit and that Panzer IV is going to be burning. There we go. Mirage Flyer though is maintaining good map control, keeping up the pressure there versus Edel Shrapnel. And denying him access to resource here and there. He might have to rush at a Stuk though. Sturmgeschütz could be helpful there. Mortar emplacement doing alright there for Edel Shrapnel. He could still perhaps consider getting a buff or to provide a bit of extra support to help him hold some of the more exposed points. And you know, for example, also provide some light artillery support wherever needed in the vicinity. Going for the victory points, mining down there, good work. But at the same time, if that were me, I would actually wait until he's been rendered neutral, because points do have a bit of line of sight. There's a small chance here, Mirage is going to notice what's happening. I mean, he might not, but there's always that slight chance. So you always wait until the point has been neutral before I begin laying down any mines right next to a point. Just in that off chance my opponent is actually paying attention. Looks like Mirage Blast not planning for a Stugan, perhaps another Panzer 4. But he's really preparing for some big assaults as we capture the western side, but at the same time the eastern side is, well, quite vulnerable. Tank support of our infantry making a push up here on the eastern side, and there we go. Land matches out there for Edel Shrapnel. The land coming from is basically based on a sort of, well, naval version. And thus this became known as the land matches. Fun fact there. Panzer gonna be here, continuing to make work there. Oh, another gonna be escort there. Annihilate, looks like the ones with the light machine gun, in fact. Those mines are proving quite potent there for Edel Shrapnel. So are the Panzer Grenadiers for Mirage Flyer. Cromwell though rushing hit pack 14 about support. Stuart got any kind of armor really would be helpful though. And there we go, Cromwell shoots. Doesn't score a hit pack 40. Expects his opponent apparently to sort of remain within the own set. We can just see that Edel Shrapnel is just blitzing through, forcing both Panzers to retreat there. Good work, less good gunnery. Come on, Nathan! I've seen better than that in North Africa. You were in North Africa, sir. Shut up. Section on the up, then the troops. Cromwell just continue to rush through there. Veterans ones now act as access to smoke rounds, which could make things even more difficult for the pack full to just smoke it, just keep driving around and shooting at it. Looks like Edel Shrapnel's not planning on that, of course. Good barrage here from the land matches, a lot of damage, whether it be white phosphorus or not quite as phosphorus. He's going for the high close of barrage. He's shooting around here. Cromwell with the damage engine trying to get away. One option now, I think, to try and use tactical movement. I believe Pat Fulton is also benefiting from that, and maybe it's just the other support ones. Just basically trying to hunt down the Cromwell with that. But looks like with the damage engine, it's good to get away here. Stug on the way from Mirage Flan, the 21st, but now we see that the table's quickly turned there. Ebel Shrapnel is now the one in control of the battlefield. He's also pushing back in the land from Atrus. Oi, Reginald, your mother's a land mattress. Shut up! Mines. And another assault tier. Note that Mirage has acted quick to sort of shift his attention to attacks, and they were just quite snoop. Keeps hammering away at one point. Like an old enthusiastic carpenter. He's always shifting his attacks and his approach, so that's kind of good there to see. Definitely worthy of play. Oh, wipe the sappers there. Flamethrower drop too. Quickly! Save the flamethrower! But what about ourselves? Save the flamethrower! Alright. Both Panzer Squads now veteran two barley vehicles coming up there. Mike will probably suppress them. Not Mike. Will. At the same time, we got vehicle crew repairs being utilized to quickly fix up the Cromwells. That quickly certainly does the trick there. Soon get another tank. Could also consider throwing in an extra infiltration unit, sort of strike here and there. Got the Stuke hanging back here so far from Mirage Flat. Not doing too much there. And grabbing territory there as well.
Machine gun crew awaiting orders.
Another Vickers. He's actually lost quite a few there. Trenches going down, mines going down. Part of me thinks you should actually consider buffers, really, or maybe a 17-pounder gun. I mean, anything, just some extra weapons there. And we got tactical movement, allowing Immensal to get be a lot more aggressive, rushing forwards. Very nice use. They, you know, again, one of those rarely utilized abilities by, you know, offering a lot. There we got a white phosphorus barrister right down the German troops at the support position overhead, catching them in a huge, very, very noxious cloud. Not very nice stuff there. Section then trouble with the Panzer gunner, you're cutting them down. We got the Cromwell flanking in and getting hit in the Stuke pack 40, too far away to support. Need to stop it up, need to stop it up. Might be too late there though. Stuke already in a pretty bad position. Oh dear, Mirage Flat's caught with his leader hosing down his ankles by Edible Shrapnel, and that's going to be the Stuke down, I feel, already. And we got Vecchi 2 there for the Cromwell. Almost got the pack 40, in fact, he does, but he's got a damage in, but there's nothing to really sort of deal with him. It is time for the mid game analysis, though, in terms of damage, they're close to each other kills wise, so Edible Shrapnel is actually ahead of Mirage Flat there, so that's a bit worrying for Mirage Flat, to be honest. In terms of army value, Edible Shrapnel is also aging ahead there, though only very slightly, in fact, it seems to be sort of vanishing there. Resource float-wise, both players don't float too much, to be honest. Though they do seem to, again, here be rather close at this point, and points health-wise, it's been a lot more so and so, but with some slight advantage overall there to Mirage Fly throughout the fight, but again, things have rather turned. So, I mean, right now, Mirage Fly is in a bit of a rough position. He's lost a lot of armor. Edward Shrapnel compares, and I don't think has lost a single tank yet. He might have lost some infantry here and there, obviously, and some support weapons, but overall, he's taking back the map, and he's doing some damage there to Mirage Flyer. So Mirage Flyer needs to do something to turn things around here, which I do believe involves, amongst other things, perhaps supporting his armor a bit better and working with it a bit better. He does seem to leave him a bit there out to, well, dry at points then, that does give Edel Shrapnel a better chance of quickly knocking him out there with a few good hits. That's definitely something Mirage Flight needs to be looking into. I mean, it's good use of Panzer Grenadiers though, a bit rare to see as well, so thumbs up there, but the armor handling definitely needs some work there. It could consider half-track, maybe some Regal Mines in there, could actually give him some extra needed assistance. A howitzer could also work out. A bit of artillery here and there. So we'll knock out some of Edible Shrapnel support weapons. That could work out nicely for Mirage Flight, but otherwise Panzers probably some pounds of force, maybe supported by Stu, could work out quite nicely for him. And some more pressure here on the right flank again. He's sort of, you know, keep Edible Strapman sort of on the defensive and sort of reacting to Mirajkla's move. Otherwise, Mirajkla could find himself being slowly crushed here by Edible Strapman, who now, of course, has a mortar emplacement veterinary 2 and a land mattress rocket launcher. There's definitely potential for trouble there for Mirajkla down the road if he doesn't fix that. But at the same time, Edible Strapman does have a few problems with only infantry-wise. He's not quite looking strong there as Mirajkla. He's got a lot of sections, well, a bunch of them, but they're not quite upgraded. No bolstered sections, no weapon racks, no nothing, and nor are there any sort of commanders anymore. So in that sense, he's a bit weaker there. And he definitely needs more tanks as well, at least to make up for it there. Of course, the question is, should he go for another Cromwell now? Should he try and play for the Comet? In which case, you know, fuel cache would also be a good idea there. More mines for Edible Strapman would be good, but I do think he needs to consider some Bren guns for his sections and some bolted sections. What you can do to make them stronger and more damaging towards Mirajkla's infantry, otherwise Mirajkla's Panzer Grenadiers could actually have a good chance of dominating the fight as things progress. So that's really something that Edible Strapman should be worried about. More push here for the victory points there, and the fuel point there, though, is also something Edible Strapman should consider. In particular, I think he's got a huge victory point need there. It's a good way of actually just stressing out Mirajkla and sort of keeping on the back foot, but just, you know, pushing for the victory points. So that would not be an entirely bad idea there for Admiral Shrapnel to consider. But let's return to the fight and see what happens. And again, I do think Admiral Shrapnel at this stage might consider getting up some buffers here and there. Just to say, lock down some points and make it harder for Mirajkla to harass him. Cromwell is rolling back. Vetchen did too. At 40, abandoned. Section moves straight into the Panzer Grenadier there, and they are quickly sent rushing back as well. Got fresh infiltration commanders out. Being right behind them. Section needs to go away. Black Gammon Bomb should be going off there as quickly as possible before the Panzers do too much damage. Bit slow there in reaction. Oh! Oh, Mirajkla was too slow there. Perhaps treated like a regular grenade. The problem is, the light Garen bomb is a lot more effective than all regular grenades, while also being cheaper. It has a very good chance of wiping you if you don't move immediately. That's a little important detail there to keep in mind. We got Panthor on 4 pound each, trying to get to deal with the 6 pound gun, but the Panthor's all down to half health here. Thankfully, his tank's been slowly repaired, so there's nothing we need to pursue the Panzer IV. In fact, it's close to being knocked out there, though. Needs to be careful there, Mirajkla. 4-6. 6 pounder gun down. Flamethrower, there's drop. In fact, he had double flamethrowers on that. One of his own, plus the British one. Then it's making a move there for the German one there, the Flammenwerfer. At least they're trying for it. Some forcing, healing up. And there you go, white Foster's Bower straight on the center. Lining up the entire area. Like a dysfunctional Christmas ornament. But Vetchin's one already here on the commandos, giving them access to the light smoke grenade. Vickers there needs some healing, Grenadiers need reinforcement, and Panzer IV is being finally repaired there. Panzer IV moving up, will be getting more Panzer Grenadier, what will Mirajkla do? 6 pounder gun is recruited, pushing towards the west there, good work. No sign of anything further there. He certainly has the resources now to play, I think, for the Comet. There's still no sign there, no additional armor. I mean, he could also just gone for some Cromwells by now, just rolled over Mirajkla. I think would struggle versus 2 or 3 Cromwells all in all. Panther moving up, getting the section there. Cromwell on the 5 from the pack 40. And he's quickly pushed back there. Almost got the section there for the Panzer under the end. The Panzer comes back in fear. And German mortar there's getting absolutely hammered there by the British mortar crew. Almost section 23. Slowly moving towards here, being a bit cautious, spotting it, watching out for any Huns that might be hiding behind the bushes. Nothing further there.
Ready for orders.
HMG here.
Yes.
Crowell tank reporting.
Ah. Two pioneers dead there to the Cromwell. Charging ahead. Infantry there, with the Panzer support making move towards the centre. We got the Vickers there covering up. Nice, of course, got the mortar. And we got the land mantras almost ready to fire another devastating barrage against Mirage Flower's men. Ooh, move towards here. Might be going for the artillery now. Not bad, not bad.
Skills are being readied.
And he's going for hammer. That means the Comet Panzer needs to pull back, though. Not raising the mortar emplacement. And there we go. So that definitely means a Comet there for Admiral Shrapnel. Commander's taking hits there. Six-pounder gun, also a problem. Down to half health already. Very slowly moving towards here. Still no real effort in the eastern side. Seems to be in large regard, maybe Mirage Flat.
We are losing the sector.
Of course, I mean, it's already been forgotten by Admiral Shrapnel. Consider that if he takes a Cromwell now, maybe support by Comet later on, and this is the way to try and charge through here into the eastern side, get behind all of Mirage Flower's support units, combining it, say, with a land mantras barrage, you could probably do a lot of damage to Mirage Flower. Instead, he's lost to Cromwell. Oh dear, Ryan's the double pack force on the Panzer IV. He got the Panzer IV, but that was a veteran to Cromwell, and I'm not sure now why he's firing white phosphorus here. Well, yeah, it's just a regular barrage to all all these support weapons are. I think that was a bit of a mistake there by Admiral Shrapnel. Paying the emplacement. Moments away from the Comet, just needs the manpower. Continue moving here in the west. More Panzergrenadiere from Mirage Flower for Deutschland. Section being suppressed.
Threatening a capture point.
Going for the victory point. Section not quite reacting to that. Still there, he's denying Mirage Flower precious fuel as well. Of course, when Mirage Flower expecting the Comet, maybe going for more Stukes, he's just going to stick to the Panzer IVs from now on. That is a rather good question. There we go. Engagement Panzers now veteran to 3 versus Sections. Section does not stand a chance against the Reich's finest. There we go. Comet on the way there. For Admiral Shrapnel.
Enemy causing trouble, trying to
mortars continue to do a lot there, but really the British mortar place just has the advantage. Even with that advanced emplacement doctrine, the regiment. Vickers almost wiped. Another mortar from Mirage Flat. Another Werfer. To Werf his way to victory. Pack 40 is just waiting, covering the center.
Tell us what to do. Get ready. They're charging us.
Bit of movement here. Fighting seems to be losing a bit of intensity for the time being. But the Comet has arrived. And he's adding in a tank commander there as well. Good work. Pretty much a no-brainer in terms of upgrades, though. Cheap, and really just adds a bonus there to the tanks. And Mirage Flower's yet to get any armor, so Admiral Shrapnel, unless he plays it like a complete putz, should have some good advantages there with this Comet while that lasts. Though charging it straight into the pack 40s is not going to help. Again, that's rather what I was sort of talking about being a putz. Don't worry, lads, they probably won't expect us to attack head on again. White phosphorus. That kinda works. Edward Shrapnel there taking further losses, he's quickly utilizing the vehicle crew repairs. So he doesn't have to send us in to deal with it, though of course it is expensive to use just for a single tank. It's really much an ability that becomes better the more armor you actually have. They're following up, Panzer Grenadier Commandos. Can't hit the stationary Comet. Good shooting, Jürgen. Commander's challenge to the Panzer are taking losses. Bitten to three Panzer are doing what they can. Comet active. Need to get those Panzer Grenadiers out of there. And now that Pack 40 is in a lot of trouble. There we go, wiped out. There's one Pack 40 that's still got another one covering there. Need to pull back the Comet. Need it repaired. All sections on the way there for edible shrapnel. Large chunk of infantry setting up. We now got Panzerjägers out there for the last one. Some Panzer going to deal with Panzer Schrecks.
Emplacement under attack. Comet, ready to move out. A new infantry section is ready for battle.
There we go, another section. And that would just be a good time for a regular barrage there. And so many units just close to each other. And another tactical movement from Mirage. Rushing up the Panzerjägers and the Flamethrower team there with double Flamethrowers to quickly knock it out.
The enemy are attacking an emplacement.
Panzer need to be careful, got commands moving up, kind of light gamble on they're being threatened with. I think, and there you go. Sent running, still got the Pioneers for the commanders, have a good chance of dealing with those. Grenade, there we go, Pioneer said running as well. It was a bullet attempt there by Mirage Flat. Nice use of tactical movement, but ultimately couldn't quite get to work out there. Grabbing the point there with the Pioneers. And we got another Panzer Fort here by Mirage Flat. Feeling pretty confident, maybe feels like going up with a Comet with just a Panzer IV. And of course, he's playing support with the Stug. Meanwhile, there we go, Rocket Strike. Hitting the support weapons, the tank a bit there. Doing quite a bit of damage there, killing quite a few units, gaining veterans he won. Nasty barrage there versus Mirage. He's still quite far behind in victory points. More sappers arriving for edible shrapnel.
An engineer unit is ready for
there
action.
We go, commanders flanking on the support weapons. Quick light gammon.
We're losing a capture point.
Wiping the mortar crew utterly. Might want to grab that pack 40 there, Mr. Edward Shrapnel, turning against me last up, but no. Comet setting out. 6 pound then gun, not quite there either. There we go, there we go, good hit from the Comet on the Panzer 4. Almost Richard Tron getting access to white phosphorus, and there you go. Could use that to smoke out the Pack 40. A very handy ability. Well, it's not one a lot of people use, but it is pretty good. Oh, machine gun wipe right from the Pack 40. Mirage is nothing to do with support weapons. Use the white phosphorus, edible shrapnel. Use the white phosphorus. Targeting point going off, though. Panzerex as well. Use the white phosphorus as soon as he could. And we got a half check on the way there from Mirage Flat. 251. My God.
Damned enemies trying to take.
Cromwell, a Comet almost knocked out. There we go. In fact, he's kaput. Even used tactical advance there.
A Comet tank has been
tactical
put
movement.
Out of action.
Tactical runny runny. Quick barrage. Trying to break up his advance here in the center. Getting a few kills, but ultimately he can just reinforce those. And in theory, he could also continue laying down some Regal mines. But the loss of that Comet hurt Edel Shrapnel quite a bit there. He should have supported, but he should also use the White Phosphorus again. When you have a Comet, it hits veterans one. Be sure to use White Phosphorus. It's one of the best abilities to negate a Pack 40 on the spot. Because it can't shoot, and it'll quickly die if it remains anyway, since that White Phosphorus can kill. It's an absolutely amazing ability.
Strength
of 6 pound a gun, the crew heroically firing away. Crewing weapons, they're using the half track to just reinforce on the spot. Showing he doesn't have to retreat them. Good work there.
Infantry can march double time.
I mean, a late game half track, the 251 is incredibly rare. So again, it's nice to see sort of Mirage Flat going for things you just don't see used very often. Another comet there for Edible Shrapnel. Nothing there from Mirage Flat. And there we go, he's laying down the Regal Mines. My God. That is about three abilities out of the five of the Doctrine. Edible Shrapnel's made, well, four out of five. That's a real positive. That's positive when the both sides actually make use of, I mean, at least half of their abilities in a Doctrine. Ready to do our bit. Yes.
You'll find it very bracing up there.
There we go. Ready to go. Comet number two. To succeed where the first one failed.
Causing trouble, trying to take one of our points.
There we go, quick arm engagement. Mortar hiding here in the alley. Allowing it to come around here. Still overall, Edible Shrapnel's got control of the victory point still. Bleeding out Mirage Flat still. Not good news, there we go. Another barrage here. In this case, using the White Phosphorus to force the mortar out of the, well, alley, in fact, killing it right on the spot there. Nasty whack there, almost stretching you two on it.
A capture point is being overrun.
Half track here, actually, he's probably trying to snuff out any units hiding there from, he's not quite succeeding. Edible Shrapnel in this case is like, you know, cool. Quick engagement off your comet strikes. Commander's still doing nothing there. But there you go, they drop the surprise on the Gunnadiers and wipe the entire unit, flame for a machine gun and everything. Retreat before the half track, but still, just wiping that Gunnadier squad is huge there for Edible Shrapnel. I mean, that's a lot of damage done there.
Yes. Ready.
Still no further sign of armor there for Mirage Flat. Is there any other mines out there? Seems like that's the only mine he's got.
Where do you want us?
Perhaps they're over here. You got S mines though. Oh, there we go, another mine. He's basically fortifying the western side of the map. It seems like the attack's going to come from these. We've got a fresh mortar emplacement up to support it. Looks like he might be preparing for a big attack here. Still lacking, though, in the abilities to support weapon racks in bolted section, but of course, he could try and combine it with an advanced cover combat. By the way, assault's commencing. Panzer and Leopard 40 opening up. Few hits there, Pack 40 firing, Comet down to half health. Panzer 4, Pack 40's Pioneers flanking in by the looks of it, getting past the 40, which is actually not still. Panzer 4 doubling back, Pioneers moving up here attacking, Pack 40 as well. Good advance a bit further for support. We've got smoke going down there, there's actually some vehicle crew repairs already. I think that's a bit of a poor timing there for Admiral Shrapnel. Pioneers have been engaged by Sappers. After doing nothing, mortars firing away there. Section being pushed back. Straight into the double flamethrowers of the Pioneers. There we go, Comet rushes forward straight into the anti-tank guns. Target weak point, Veteran G2. Didn't even pop White Phosphorus, there you go. That tank is going down. Like the British at Dunkirk. There we go. Well, not quite that down, but you know. not combat functional. There you go, that edible shrapnel surrenders. His will broken as his tank is broken. So there you go, first match is sort of proper new fight there with the hotfix out. And with the new commanders, we've got mobile assault here. I wouldn't say that was the best usage of it, but certainly there's some interesting British play here. Some slightly less than usual play there, considering how things have gone for the last couple of months there when it comes to fighting the British. Mirage Plus certainly also played the Wehrmacht in a pretty different way. Make good use of Storm, I would say. Half tracks, Panzer Grenadiers, and so on. I mean, two thumbs up there to Mirage Plus. Early game, though, his armor preservation, I think, could have worked a bit better. The Stuga in particular, I think, was just wasted, so that's a bit unfortunate. Edward Shrapnel, I think, should upgrade his infantry, put a bit more focus on the sections in particular. That was something that could benefit him more. And, you know, I do think, pardon me, again, a few buffers here and there could have done a lot there for him as well. But there you go. Hope you enjoyed this, the 1000th episode. I hope you had some fun. I hope you learned some things. If you did, you know, subscribe, tell your friends, share it with everyone. And, of course, remember to press like. The more the like it, the better. And if not, you know, send a new player part some feedback in the comment section. And this is Imperial Danger. Cheers, and hope to see you all for another 1000th episode. Cheers.